speech before, which I came in about halfway through, it kind of resonated with me. I'm invested in a few companies in and around that space. I'm invested in a company called Onshape, which is a CAD tool that's completely hosted in the cloud. We like to think it's better than Fusion at Autodesk, Fusion 360. It's still getting to market, and it's fully production ready, we'd like to think, and it's ramping quickly in terms of sales. These were the founders of SolidWorks, John Hirschnick and John McLaney, and we have the Series B. I also have a company in the 3D printing space that will be launching in just about 4 weeks, called Desktop Metal. They're a 3D printing company that can actually print molten metals. It is not a consumer-priced product, but it is priced for the low end of the enterprise market. So the printers will be around $100,000, and then they do have a fuller size production printer. But they can print actually molten metals, so not powder-based laser printing for metals, but a more traditional approach, which that's all I'll say for now until it's unveiled in May. I also have a couple of companies in and around the manufacturing tech space. So actually, one of our big theses on the enterprise side at NEA is digitizing the shop floor, digitizing manufacturing. There are literally, if you go, and I encourage you to go in the space, to manufacturing facilities as varied as those, from Flextronics to New Balance in Maine. And what you'll see is a really environment that web entrepreneurs would call pre-web 1.0, manufacturing shop floor, where if they're assembling consumer products, they're walking to the end of the line and hitting a counter, or they're writing things up on a whiteboard, and perhaps the plant manager is transcribing them into Excel at the end of the day to figure out how to better optimize the plant. And so we as tech entrepreneurs go into those environments and say, oh, you need a rethink robot, or you need this fabulous technology that you're gonna install on all your plant lines overnight, and it's gonna dramatically improve your efficiency. And that's just not the way these environments are accustomed, or not the way they will be accustomed to buying. The plant manager goes home every day not thinking about how can I spend millions of dollars to transform my factory, but how can I get, employees A, to show up on time the next day, but B, how to optimize a certain line that suddenly isn't as productive as it was last week. So I've made two investments around this space that are kind of meeting the plant floor where it is. Enabling one line at a time, enabling a plant manager to buy the technology and digitize or instrument it overnight. One company is that we recently closed called Tulip. It's in Boston, and it's an IoT gateway that can measure, can actually instrument a tool on the line and can tell how productive you are. You're being using those tools, or the whole line is productive using their tools in a certain day. And they project a very simple analytics dashboard that would be like Mixpanel to the consumer world, consumer internet world, and totally gives the plant manager suddenly tools automatically in real time that they've never had before. But it's not plant-wide, it's just consumable and easily moved around and instrumented where that shop floor manager needs. So those are some examples. We also, as a firm, have done a lot in the consumer world as well. I have two consumer investments, one that's not what that I did not lead, but our firm did, other than Casper, who is a claim to fame around here, that we've attached ourselves to too. It was also Jet.com that sold to Walmart. We led the Series A there as well. So that's a great example of NEA's power of the size of our fund, that we were able to lead what was a small, $50 million seed round, basically, which is not typical, but it is, when we want to be in business with certain entrepreneurs, we break the rules, and sometimes we are rewarded for that. Sometimes we're not. So what else can I tell you?
What are you looking for these days?
What am I looking for these days? I'd say, one thing, maybe what we can talk about is what I'm
not looking for, or maybe what you guys could help us with in understanding, is the future of sort of enterprise deep tech systems software, you know, database technology. We think that maybe Amazon and Google are going to move further into that space, really crowd out some of the would-be, you know, standalone companies there the same way that they took over cloud computing. So we're scratching our heads to figure out that space. I'm looking for, you know, I wouldn't say I'm looking for necessarily more manufacturing digitization investments, but using that analogy of finding sort of the last mile of digitization, you know, Onshape, as I mentioned, the company that's bringing CAD to the cloud, this is, you know, for all of us who are regular web, enterprise, productive software users in the professional world, we just can't imagine that CAD has not been moved into the cloud, but it really is still being bought and used in a license-based model with products like SolidWorks, and it has been that way since the mid-90s. So that type of analogy, the manufacturing type of analogy, are ones that we're really looking at, you know, how do you bring the last mile of digitization to the end user, whether it's consumer or business. And the consumer side, you know, I stopped shopping in retail stores, I think, in 2010. I actually, in 2010, said I'm gonna try the whole year not to step into a store. I had my first child that year, so it was easier than I imagined because I had no time to do that. But now they're officially claiming retail is dead, malls have gone away, not because they're unpleasant, but because, you know, everybody's really buying stuff online. It has officially tipped. And more, you know, in 2010, I think there were only 25% of all commerce was being bought via e-commerce and online. And now I don't know what the exact number is, but it's well over 75%. So we're looking at new models of how consumers will buy. It's not just going to be everything on Amazon or even Jet. There's a lot of personal commerce that we're looking into. There's probably new models of actually retail pop-ups, but more specialized. I read, actually in my neighborhood, we have Barnes & Noble, and on like our community listserv the other day, they are petitioning to keep the rent down so Barnes & Noble can stay there. I don't understand this. What's going on? Isn't that what Barnes & Noble did to all the local bookstores? And that's the world we're living in right now. The big box retailers can't afford to pay the rent anymore. And so what's going to go there? Is it going to be empty space? I don't think so. I think there's going to be another resurgence of local boutiques and discovery places, things that you can't get online again. And so whether that's, you know, a pop-up, you know, a Bonobo store, or Warby Parker, Casper, or whether it's some other discovery element. There will be a mixed model of purchasing that will not be strictly online, but it will be, you know, sometimes in your home, too. There'll be personal services that come to your home. I think that's a viable model in the future. So we're looking at a lot of different personal commerce models right now. You know, another problem that I'm interested in, I don't know exactly what the solution is there other than Hyperloop one, but I think there's a trend towards these mega cities, possibly because I encounter the problem every week between DC, Boston, and New York. I think the same problem exists between, frankly, Menlo Park and San Francisco and then LA, that you see these, you know, it's not just the coastal towns, it's the coastal mega cities emerging. And so how we're gonna solve that problem, whether it's, you know, better real-time video and communication, whether it's better transportation, whether it's some AR solution, something else that I've been scratching my head around. And then there's a number of other sort of, niche things. You know, I often say that we, you know, people ask me whether we're investment thesis driven in our approach to investing. I would say yes, in that, you know, the themes I just mentioned are ones broadly that I'm looking at, but we don't get too granular in figuring out we want this model to be solved exactly this way, and we could only find an entrepreneur doing exactly that, that kind of violates the whole spirit of entrepreneurship, and that we are not the entrepreneurs. We're looking for the thing we weren't thinking about. We're looking for, as soon as we get too thesis driven, some great, you know, A plus entrepreneur walks through the door and we cast aside all of her work and we say we just want to be in business with him or her. And it might be something we totally are not thinking about. And that's what, you know, that's when we know our model's really working, because we got to see that opportunity versus prescribe the opportunity.
Take some questions. Anyone has any questions? Or anyone wants money?
Yes, in the back.
How do I approach you with transportation?
Sorry?
How do I approach you with transportation?
Oh, with a transportation investment? I mean, I think the best way, first of all, you know, I guess you just did, but. But you can email me, you can send, you can join, you know, you can ping me on LinkedIn, and then, you know, there's no sort of formal process of just reaching out to someone and sharing your idea. Go ahead.
Hi. So I think it's really interesting that you brought up the fact that retail is dying, and I certainly believe that, because I was a blogger for a while, and like the biggest problem was getting wardrobe and like obtaining designer wardrobe and just like staying relevant in something like creating content and social media. So I was just wondering if when you're looking at a model, because I don't want to like pitch, but I have like a subscription model service, like is that something that you see is like becoming the norm, or like?
I mean, I think, yeah, whether subscription commerce is the right approach or not, I think it just depends. You know, it depends. I think they're, you know, Stitch Fix is a beautiful business. It's done phenomenally well. I hear they're going to go public someday. But, you know, I think Harry's is a great subscription business, or Dollar Shave Club. I get my coffee via subscription. But there's not, you know, I wouldn't want to get everything via subscription. So it just sort of depends on what it is. I think people, like I said, are more open to services perhaps in their home too. Just depends, you know, it could be an actual person coming to your home. I'm an investor in Glam Squad here in New York that, you know, people think about as like hair and makeup at your house, but it's really about creating that trusted relationship of
convenience,
sending someone to your home, and then they can eventually sell you things in your home too. Go ahead.
So you covered a lot of different sort of verticals, sectors. How do you learn? Like, how do you know the resources and processes?
Yeah, I mean, especially things like the manufacturing tech. I mean, we learn as much from our entrepreneurs and our existing investments as anything, because, you know, how do you not learn? You can't learn via Gartner reports, because by the time a Gartner report is written, those companies are way too big and expensive for us to invest in. So we, you know, my investment in Onshape then led me to Desktop Metal, then led me to the manufacturing space, and so it's always a tangential jump from one to the other. And then, you know, after we start to see a bunch of different entrepreneurs and our ideas in one space, then we will absolutely dive in and write an investment thesis. We have a whole investment thesis on manufacturing tech. And industrial IoT that goes with that, you know, AI and AR, and how it affects that industry.
You were mentioning about online retail, and I'm wondering if you made any investment in body scan, because Fit is really the big holy grail of online retail, and that's my best area.
We haven't made any investments in body scanning or Fit. And I don't think, I think it's because we haven't seen the right approach to that yet. It's a tough, you know, space. We have a company that's a bra company that was doing sort of, you know, take a picture and then you can, you know, people just don't want to sit in front of a mirror and take a picture of themselves and upload it to the web, at least not most people. So least not the ones that are buying, you know, clothes online. Body scanning, it's a very personal thing that, you know, most people don't want to do. And so what is the right approach there? I mean, we're still open to it. At the same time, it's very hard to buy, you know, consistent sizes even from the same brand online. So I know it's a problem. I think right now it's just been solved by easy returns and shipping, but it's still a problem.
They're using a lot of AI and trying to figure out what that person does fit into regard to brand. But there are the solutions for body scanning that are very new.
Yeah. Okay.
How do you evaluate a company? Like, a lot of people are saying, a lot of startups has over-evaluated.
How do we value a company?
To make sure it's right.
Yeah, it's more, you know, at the really early stages, there's no revenue. So usually, so it's very hard to say based on multiples of revenue, this is what your company is worth. It's more about how much capital do you need over, you know, say the next 18 to 24 months. And let's talk about that. Let's talk about what you're going to use that capital for, what you're going to be able to achieve, and what type of value you'll be able to build. And then we say, you know, then it's a discussion around how much of the company you want to sell, or you're open to selling, and how much we need to, eventually we like to own 20% in our companies. We don't often own that the first time we invest. Sometimes that's why we invest super early sometimes, like just $1 million check. We'll buy 10% ownership and then try to build ownership over time. Or sometimes, you know, we think it's such a great idea and entrepreneur, we'll bend the rules and, you know, write a big check, but only own 15%. So it just depends, but that's the math that determines the value of the company. Certainly when we invest at later stages where they have revenue and metrics, it's a lot easier to do comparable analysis of other companies and come up with a value.
You must be inundated with information. How do you consume information and what are your favorite sources of it?
That's a good question. I am inundated with information. I try not to read information on Facebook. I always start with what I'm not going to do first. I was an investor in Pocket, so I love Pocket. I love saving information there, and I love following people on Pocket because it's probably the best source of quality. Other than that, I just have, you know, I still have like an old-fashioned blog reader that I still follow my favorite site through. I think I'm like the only user left of their technology. but that's probably the best. I mean, frankly, I think that's a problem that is still yet to be solved, especially given the fake news phenomenon and the echo chamber that we've all created for ourselves. Go ahead.
What do you think about
Social entrepreneurship and investing in nonprofits. There are several impact investors, is sort of the name of that sector, especially in DC where I live. There's a company called, or a fund called Rethink that does a lot of impact investing. We are not a double bottom, you know, or otherwise called double bottom line investors. We are not a double bottom line investor. It doesn't mean we're not socially conscious. It just means that our priority is just on more financial drivers. So I think there's definitely a place for it. There's a lot of people, you know, in funds that are focused on it. And we do have, you know, we're invested in an education company in Africa called Bridge International. I'd say that's a double bottom line. And so it happens sort of by circumstance versus by mission for us. I don't know if the shipping industry has made it easier. I think you know, Zappos and others that have allowed free returns have made it easier. I don't know if the economic model is really there, so there's still a lot of broken things in that model. One more question in the back.
Do you have any thoughts on advertising tech or out-of-home networks?
Advertising tech, you know, we have not done a lot in the digital media or ad tech world in several years because of Google and Facebook sucking up 90% of the ad budgets. There's been really, it's been a really tough space for startups in that world. We were investors in Millennial Media. Before that, we were investors in ad.com, which was a much better story. So it's been a really tough space.
Great. Thanks so much. So before we start with the companies, my name is Murat. I'm the co-founder of ERA. Here we have our operating partner, Justin Smithline. Our operations manager, Penny, is in the back. Emily was sitting next to me, right there, our program manager. And Jeremy, our senior principal, is also sitting there. So after this, you may come find us if you want to talk about the summer program. But now we have five really awesome companies. We had lots of applications this month to pitch to Dana, so we picked five of them. And if there is enough time, at the very end, Dana will pick one more company to pitch impromptu. So it's gonna be fun, so we'll play that game. But our first company is Heather Wetzler with Q Career. She has 4 minutes starting right now.
Hi, I'm Heather Wetzler. I'm with Q Career. Q Career is a
career exploration and career readiness platform for students, linking students to professional associations. We aggregate the resources from over 100,000 professional associations into one location. Q Career student interns then make short video interviews with young professionals that that are student friendly for career exploration, and lead students to professional development opportunities such as internships, mentorships, badging, and micro-credentialing. The associations are facing waning membership numbers. So by helping the students, they strengthen their recruitment strategy and by giving them valuable resources. So what does all this mean? We're a two-sided marketplace and we're solving for two problems. So the first problem is with the students. The students are leaving university unprepared for the workforce, which is known as the skills gap. Universities are not able to keep up with the modern workforce. The second problem we're solving for is for professional associations. Their membership is flat or declining. Millennials aren't joining as fast as the generations previous, and students don't even know what a professional association is. So how we're basically doing this is the platform is helping them with all of the resources as we aggregate it. And before we could even start though with the skills gap, there's an exposure gap. So students are only exposed to typical career domains such as lawyer, teacher, doctor, and then whatever their parents do for a living. So, and there's three constituent groups that all want the same thing. The educators, the students, and the employers all want these students to be gainfully employed, but they're not traveling on the same road, and the road does not intersect. So that's where Q Career comes in. So we have built the bridge that intersects the roads. So think of it as, you know, this problem is really fueling the economy for the boot camps. So General Assembly, Galvanize. So Q Career, in essence, is a boot camp for all the other career domains out there. So how we're doing this is right now we have an MVP built. So students go and they log in and they search for careers and they watch the videos, and then they could hook up with the associations and find out more about credentialing, micro badging. There's nano degrees now. So what we're testing for right now in our beta is the length of our videos. So with this generation, obviously it's important to figure out what their attention span is and how it's too long, and making sure that the professional videos get their attention, and that doesn't have to be like Snapchat, but we'll see. So we're testing it now. Right now the videos are around 5 minutes, so it looks like we're gonna have to curate that down. So what we'll probably end up doing is they'll watch the beginning of the video and then there'll be extras there that they could hook up to. So The most important thing for investors out there is that we are, even though we're considered education technology, it's free for students and universities. We charge the associations a yearly subscription fee. So our ask is $500,000, basically just to get more of the video contents up and running quickly, to build out some of our UI UX features, and for marketing. So, and that's it.
So I think that you're absolutely right in the mega trends that you're seeing, the skills gap, the exposure gap. This Generation Z is very nuanced and different than millennials. They, you know, there's stats about they've all worked independently as freelancers or contractors and on their own before they even graduate from high school. And I think, you know, that sense of empowerment and curiosity will continue. And so I think whether it's videos or some other medium, which you'll figure out on how to best train them for, you know, the quote unquote real world, is a good idea. The part of the model that I'm not quite sure about is, you know, the business model part. You know, associations are shrinking, so it's therefore a shrinking market, and I would go after growing markets just broadly. There's many other stakeholders that could monetize this platform for you, and so I would consider not solving that problem for associations.
Thank you for your feedback. I think one thing about associations, though, is that their data points for career changes and career paths, so they're really on the forefront. And because they are trying to attract younger members, some are doing better than others, right? And some are more student-friendly. But they've come up with all these certifications that they're charging for that are less expensive than the boot camps. So some of them are doing better than others. So for us, I think it's leveraging that data. So when we were talking to IBM this week, and they obviously have, well, not obviously, but they are starting to do AI around recommending your next job. A lot of people think job boards are gonna go away. So that's basically gonna be all AI focused. So the amount of data that the associations have too could be an interesting play too. I mean, being in, I worked in marketing and internet advertising sales for a very long time. I think that, it's like working in digital, like we saw what was gonna happen to TV and print advertising, like, you know, way before, you know, the markets, because we're part of that association, because we all know. So I think that, I mean, maybe not solving their problem, but leveraging that data, I think could really help the students and the certificates that they offer and the education that they offer, and having students lead through that.
So maybe what you should do is just focus on a few different main associations and figuring out what's unique about their needs before going more broadly after every association.
Vintage. So next company is Mirgesh with Thrillbits. There you go. Thanks for coming. It's difficult to come up here and pitch, so let's support the entrepreneur, right?
Hello, my name is Mirgesh. I'm an acoustic imaging scientist and founder of Thrillbit. Today I'm going to introduce you to Internet of Sound. We have created a new data communication protocol, which is a whole lot powerful. And but it's based on a very simple idea of sound. The holy grail of messaging is to give correct information to right people at right location at right time. But it's tricky. And that's why you keep hearing terms about like proximity marketing, second screen interactions. Technologies like Bluetooth, NFC, beacons, they try to overcome this problem, but they have a few deficiencies. They need lots of hardware, they need cost, the reach is a problem, and also it is dependent on multiple platforms. What we do is, we can send data, we can connect devices, any devices which has a speaker or microphone. Just think about it, we are surrounded by speakers here. track your journey from car, retail shop, coffee shops, auditoriums, you go to any events, everywhere speakers are still in place. With our technology, we can connect it right now without any hardware. So how do we do it? We add an information on ultrasonic tones. These tones you cannot hear. These tones are above human hearing level. But once you go to a proximity, it triggers a meaningful interaction. So our technology has lots of application, but what we see is the two biggest verticals for us are proximity marketing or hyperlocal marketing and broadcast industry. So let's say hyperlocal marketing. In 85% of us uses a mobile device inside a retail store. Now, we can connect the retail store with your mobile device. So once you enter a store, you'll get a welcome message. Once you reach to a grocery section, you can get a meaningful coupon, whatever that you need, related to a grocery section. And once you go away from the grocery section, you can be reminded about what you have left just based on your shopping list. And once you head out, even you can pay just using your phone with our technology. Another vertical is broadcast. With our technology, we can connect TV and radio directly to your phone, and we can send data, which means once it was just a one-way communication, now it can be interactive. So when TV and radio are connected to your phone, what it means, you can grab a news article, you can get a coupon offer, you can get a travel package directly just because you are watching TV and you are interested in it, directly to your phone without any Wi-Fi, without any mobile network, just using the power of sound. So online ads are effective because they are well targeted. They have a better track of ROI. But broadcasting ads, still they have a bigger market share, but they are lacking now. They're shrinking in size. With our technology, we can bring the broadcasting ads and the online ads, the broadcasting ads as effective as online ads, almost. The hardware that we need is already in place. It needs no extra cost. All we need right now is just to plug and play. And this is precisely why our technology can bring a fundamental change in day-to-day interaction. We are running 4 pilot programs in India, US, and Nigeria. In Bangalore, in one of the pilot projects, our aim is to how we can increase the footfall in a local restaurant. In Boston, Bangalore, and in Nigeria, we are setting up thrill zones in a mall where they go to a particular section and they will get a targeted message or relevant coupons based on whatever the personal need is. And we are also talking with Indian Railway, and where they want to see how can we give a precise information about a station the passenger is reaching, and also how can we help in case of emergencies. All this would not have been possible without a great team. The Trillbit has been founded by 3 members. Bhaskar and I have a background in acoustic imaging. We both worked for Schlumberger in Houston for 5 years. Another member, he has experience in business development operation for 5 years, and he has worked with top companies. Our tech advisor, Milka, she's an MIT professor and head like in acoustic communication. She's a leading figure. John Hu, he is working with MIT Acoustic Lab. He's a great researcher. And also we have a back-end programmer, Saurabh, who has worked with multiple startups. So what we are here for is for our business opportunity, business advice, and we are looking for connection, and we are open for a pre-seed round of 250K. Thank you. I'm open for questions.
I think that's a very interesting idea and technology. It's already built somewhat?
Yes, okay. We have built and okay. We have prototyped it. Now we are doing the pilot shows to okay. Showcase our technology.
And I think sound and listening and voice is definitely, and the algorithm sort of around it and recognizing voice recognition, that's been a problem. You know, not just sound, but voice recognition has been a problem for 20 years that companies like Nuance, et cetera, kind of started around, and just now there's enough sort of data that can recognize the right sounds, can recognize the right words, can recognize everything around you that I think this is, right, I didn't mention this, one of the areas of investment, but it's something I'm also very interested in. and figuring that out. I don't know how many of you guys have an Echo at home, but it, once you see the power of that, you understand Echo can kill the phone. And the phone killed, the mobile phone killed everything else, and TV killed the radio. And so there's sound, and identifying where you are and what you're doing is definitely the next frontier in delivering services, and perhaps advertising.
Yes.
I don't know if it's going to be advertising or if it's going to be some other service.
Mm-hmm.
So I would, I would think hard about, being in the grocery store, and if that's exactly what you need to be, if that's the best use case, or, it sounds like you have a sort of platform tech approach to it, and it could be used in many different ways. So before you lock in on either, the platform approach or the right use case, test a lot of them and figure out where the most high value is.
Thanks for your feedback. Maybe I was not so clear. It's not based on voice recognition. What it does is, so any small speaker, a $1 speaker, will send ultrasonic tones, which will transfer the data. It will act like a Bluetooth. So any phone or any devices, because all the devices have a microphone, it can pick up the data.
Yes.
So, in case of Echo, like in all IoT devices, it can work brilliantly. Like right now, if you want to send the links to everyone here, so just a push of button, everyone can receive the notification on phone. You don't need to know the phone number or something like that. So these are the
signals are set off by different.
So just one speaker,
okay.
And it will cover the whole area.
Right, it's very interesting. Yeah, again, I don't know if there's been people trying to solve the sort of automatic checkout when you walk out of the grocery store, mm-hmm. to serving the right coupon when you're walking down the aisle, in many different form factors over time. And you might find that more enterprise use case of going into the train station is much more high value.
Yeah. So that's why we are doing lots of test cases, and we are evolving, and we'll find the best fit of for our technology, and that's why we know what are the challenging cases and how can we solve it. Like another thing is we are doing a pilot case with a TV station. Like the regular program, you will not hear anything, but if you want something, let's say after BBC news, when they say that go to this section, that thing can be just given from TV to your phone. You don't need to type out or Google search or do anything. You can just find it out, grab on your phone. So there are many test cases we are working around it. Let's see which one will work.
Right. Good. Very interesting.
That's very interesting. Thank you very much. So tonight, one of the companies that was coming, they just emailed me. They said they are sick. So full disclosure, the next company is an ERA company. Okay, shoot me. We never do this, but tonight, I'm very excited because Peter is here to pitch ColoX. I think it's a great company, so let's see how she pitches. And let's support her.
Hi, I'm Peter Miner, and I'm the co-founder of ColoX. It's a digital B2B marketplace for the ocean shipping industry, the $260 billion ocean shipping industry. Now, how many of you have shipped a package by UPS or FedEx? Okay, how many of you done an ocean shipping? Okay. If you've done ocean shipping, you probably know that there is about 10 steps it takes to ship something from usually where it's made in China through many different steps before it arrives at your doorstep. And in the world of e-commerce, you can order something on your iPhone through Amazon, have it delivered even that day, and yet what's happening in ocean shipping is there's about a 6-week backlog of a process to be able to get those goods to your door. So what we've built at ColoX is a digital marketplace for price discovery. And the way it works is it's targeted for the intermediaries. We're really looking very strictly at all these companies that are involved, 400,000 plus companies involved in ocean shipping. And by the simple fact of price discovery, we're helping the world of e-commerce, which is all about velocity and cost, by cutting out 80% of the time it takes to get a quote on ocean shipping, and cutting the freight cost by about 25%. And we have a very strong interest from hundreds of customers. We've got hundreds of companies participating in our marketplace today. We're generating revenues and transactions. And as well, we have I've also learned that in this world that runs right now, literally, on phone, fax, and email, that a little bit of digitization goes a long way. And once we're able to amalgamate the players, we also are planning on with our platform, building out the capability to be able to do predictive analytics, some big data applications, and as well, there's lots of applications for IoT, and as well, even blockchain. We might actually be the first use case where we can actually use blockchain technology. So we have a note open now for $500,000, and we're... Thank you. I was trying to remember that too. Actually, and the way this all got started is my co-founder and I have been in this industry combined for 4 decades. So we've been at this a long time. We've lived the pain on both sides of the transaction. And myself personally, I spent quite a bit of time at HP, Cisco, Amazon, and always on looking out at the industry. And as an engineer, also realizing that there is all sorts of opportunities to apply technology in this industry. And in fact, what's been happening last year is over $1 billion was invested in logistics startups for this very reason. It's the time is now.
We also have a couple of investments in logistics startups. You know, we talked about shipping earlier. Maybe shipping is one of those last mile industries that's going to become more and more important in logistics now that Amazon, now that e-commerce has fully tipped and is the majority of shopping now. So I think it's quite interesting. What? How would you go to market? How would you get your first customers?
Oh, we have customers. So we have hundreds of customers now using the marketplace. We've been operating since September, and it's really about discovery. So a lot of it is about sending out emails, some Google AdWords, some LinkedIn AdWords, and it's really about creating visibility. And that's
so tell me more about the experience. What is the customer experience?
Yeah. So it's a web app, and it's think Travelocity, but for ocean shipping. So if I'm looking to ship something by ocean, I go onto our web app.
And so if I'm looking to ship something by ocean, am I therefore an HP or an enterprise customer?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Yeah. But we're targeting not so much the HPs or the Apples. We're targeting the companies that serve them, the intermediaries.
Right. And so today, what are you replacing?
Phone, fax, and email. Literally. I mean, the greatest technology they have right now is an Excel spreadsheet.
And is the value prop, you know, time and money? That's
yeah.
what they're saving?
Yeah. So when you put a marketplace in place as a buyer, I have access to more sellers. And as well, the sellers have more access to buyers. Right now, it's who you know. And the value proposition for the buyer is, I because I can find more options, I can pay less. And for the sellers, it's more revenue. Yeah.
Very interesting.
Thanks for the on-the-spot pitch. I just told her she's going to pitch like 2 minutes ago. So our next company is Albert Manukyan with Annex Projects. They're going away, so okay, that's good. All right. Cool. I was like, take that up. Great. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Albert. A brief introduction about me. I was project manager and expert in SaaS and cloud service solutions design at Oracle. I have more than 10 years experience in software engineering. Before, I used to work in a startup as technical lead and vendor, where we invented the project which brought more than $25 million revenue. And after 2 years, was acquired by one of the biggest corporations in the United States. Now I work on a big idea, which calls Annex. Basically, we all are doing online shopping, and sometimes we need a customer service help. And it can be obtained by a live chat directly from websites, or we need to reach out call center via phone. So we all agree that it's frustrating to be tied to a phone or computer until we are getting customer service help. And this is where actually Annex matters. So basically, we are creating the next generation of online customer service. In the era of Siri, OK Google, Amazon Alexa, or a Google Home, we brought into existence the technology to create customer service like Google Alexa. And what's that mean? We are creating online customers, we are creating cognitive virtual sales and customer representative for businesses. Like, just think of Siri with human face, interacting and talking with your customers online. Enix looks like a real person. She can blink her eyes, smile, brave, move, and bring all emotions. Enix can talk, hear, respond, and capable to prevent your customer questions automatically. The key factor that Enix is self-training cognitive system backed by artificial intelligence that improves knowledge base by time and becoming more smarter. And the second key important factor that Enix can very accurately detect the shortage of certain information in a knowledge base and automatically escalate the conversation to the real agent while keeping the same user experience. What that means, that agent in a call center using the microphone can directly talk with the customer using the same mimics and emotions without changing any user interface. So So Enix will never leave your customer questions unresolved, basically, because it's best interaction with automatic system and machine learning and the real agent. We are more focusing on pre-sale questions because we are trying to bring the value for our customers with increasing customer acquisition, boost sales, increase retention, and also increase customer satisfaction. And we already built the MVP, minimum viable product is ready, and we are actively working with our early stage adapter customers now in the West Coast, unfortunately, or fortunately. And we are doing like very like lean startup tactic to understand the customer pain points, the questions what they have, and trying to handle that automatically. Like bring value as much as possible very quickly. Because training a system for specific business, it takes time, like several weeks. But we are starting with some knowledge base, which is improving very fast and accelerating the process. We are the team with 4 people now working on it. And yeah, that's it. I don't need so much money, to be honest. We are working and get some investment before. And that's it. And it looks like this. And it's pure browser-based solution, like SaaS, no installation, no plugins, in both in visitor side and agent side as well.
Interesting. Very very interesting technology, interesting solution, as I sort of gave a preview to earlier. I think, you know, that's another last mile problem of how do you create customer service. As if it was somebody, you know, really on the other end of the line listening to your problems. I think we've all moved, you know, somewhat past, like, I just want to talk to someone, that use case, but there's, you know, we've moved a little bit faster. It's not 100% solved, and end of the day, like, if you could get past the wait times, it would still be better to talk to somebody most of the time when you have a customer service problem. So I think, you know, it's sort of all about how well does it work. And how real is it? And you know, that's what you're trying to perfect. And it sounds like you've gotten pretty far along. I'd love to see a demo. But of these initial customers, who are you targeting?
So we have two ways. We are giving everyone like standalone solution who wants, and they are bringing their FAQ, and we are just importing to our knowledge base, and it starts to learn for them. They are more VR companies and plumbing companies, the first ones, but now we are targeting more for Shopify e-commerce solution and getting like 5 top products which we are selling, all shops based on Shopify, and trying to handle and get all the knowledge base which will bring the value for other customers. So basically we are targeting the same domain and getting the second company from same domain. So that helps us to bring also the knowledge base to that company. So we say like, we know better your business than you know, like, or we can help you to understand your customers because it's very related to your domain and we have this knowledge base which we are calculating.
And how will you price it? What's the model?
That's tricky. So we are targeting small and medium businesses, and but also we got requests from enterprise. For small and medium businesses, we just it's a SaaS solution, so we're just charging like $100 a month from them, but it's very limited with connections a month. So if it's going up, we are charging more, but it's no rules yet.
Can you customize the avatar? To, what do you call it, an avatar? What is the
Yeah, Annie Sarata. Yeah, actually we have like a girl and guy, like now we have only six, but we can customize everything, like background, colors and everything. Like we will one click. Your very simple going to admin console, then go your changes, pushing save button, it goes to cloud, Akamai, and you are done. And it appears immediately on your website, the changes.
Sounds like you're moving towards the right part of the business building, the acceptance testing, proof of, viability.
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting.
Thank you.
Great job. So it's going to replace me one day, maybe, for Entrepreneurs Roundtable. So before we go on to the last company to pitch, who here is an amazing entrepreneur who wants to come up here and pitch to Dana? She has cash in the bag. After this company pitch, who wants to come up here and pitch? Just raise your hand. I know there are more than three people here who can pitch. Yes? Guys, you can come up here and pitch to NEA, one of the largest funds in the world. And you're like, I don't want to do it. Okay, but think about it. So our next company, last but not least, is Yad Yaich with WeWest. Yes, here you go. You have 4 minutes, and congratulations.
Hey, Yad. How you doing? My name is actually Jean-Marc. Yad is my co-founder. I'm the CTO and co-founder of WeVest that helps people connect with their trusted network and savvy investors to make better investment decisions. Let's talk about someone, me, who didn't make the right decisions for a while. I've been working for the financial services industry and technology for a while and made a decent amount of money. What did I do with it? Well, I live in New York, so I spent part of it. But then I kept a lot of it in bank accounts. I was just losing money year over year. Why did I do that? I did that because I'm a millennial. I don't trust people I don't know, one. Number two is, I didn't have the amount of assets to be able to get a rock star financial advisor to help me and create a personal investment strategy for myself. After I saw that the amount of cash was piling up in my bank account and I wasn't doing anything with it, I decided I needed to do something. I reached out to, lucky me, one of my friends who's a savvy investor, my co-founder, Yad. You know, he's a savvy investor, but most importantly, he knew me. I trusted him. He could help me. He helped me make my first safe investments in ETFs, stocks. But then he introduced me to a network of investors, other people like him, like me. I'm still learning right now. So I haven't made a lot of risky investments, but it's pretty exciting. Yad and I have been thinking about this for a while, and we wanted to solve this problem for others. Others like me, others like Yad. And what we've done is we jumped ship from our jobs in the financial services industry and created WeVest. WeVest is a platform that gives you a holistic view of all your investment opportunities, real estate, stocks, startups, and robo-advisory, for instance. And it allows you to connect with the people you trust, and then savvy investors, to be able to make the right decisions. What does it do? Well, WeVest gives you a natural experience to be able to get the information that your network, the investment information of your network, for instance, their posts, shares, their public information, their watch list. It's very easy for you to connect to the right people, the people you want to connect to very quickly. It also gives you an aggregated view for all investment, just like Rotten Tomato, but for investment. There isn't such a service now. The vision is different than the beginning. Our vision is that our platform is going to be your personal advisor based on your data, your trusted network's data, and aggregated data from professional sites. Well, are people going to come to our platform? People like Yad, who's a savvy investor, are already joining platforms like AngelList for startups, BiggerPocket for real estate. But people like Yad, savvy investor, want to diversify. They know it's the right thing. Today it's a pain. You have to subscribe to dozens of sites and build a new network in each of them. Our offer gives them access to all assets. Technologists, real estate investors, financiers can connect and share their experience to help each other and make the right decisions. So they're going to join at some point. And then people like me, who need content, will start seeing their posts, will start seeing their idea, and will join as well to gain from their experience. And like me, will start investing and learning more about different possibilities. Today we have a web prototype, and we're building an app, and we're testing it today with our closed circle. We're planning on releasing it to the public in the next 3 to 4 months. We're planning also on growing the team, adding one software engineer, a social media marketing expert, and a content writer. As I told you, we need a content writer to aggregate the data and show you something like Rotten Tomatoes for investments. To be able to grow the team, we'll be looking for investment in the next 3 to 6 months. Let me tell you more. Wait, I forgot something here. Let me tell you more about this. So I think I already told you, I have a strong software development and infrastructure background. I've led teams to deliver pretty complex product in very difficult environment in the top hedge fund. Yad was an MD at UBS. He's a very savvy entrepreneur and investor, and he has a lot of experience in the financial services domain.
So I have no doubt you'd be able to build this. My larger questions would be around how you'll get people to come, like how you'll, what the cost of acquisition will be, and if you'll be able to, prove value to them in a very short consumer-like-minded time frame of this is better than you could have done on your own or through services like Robinhood or even Deswalt Farms and others. So have you thought about how you will acquire users and how you will quickly show them that this is the Rotten Tomatoes of investment worth?
Yeah, sure. So it's something that we're just approaching now. So we have different strategies. One of them is to create great content, just like Rotten Tomatoes, to push it, because you're talking about Wealthfront, Robinhood, Betterment, but these are just platforms. We sit on top of it. And frankly, when I started investing, I saw all these different possibilities, and I didn't know which one to choose. What we need to provide them is great content, and start with a niche of people, I believe, and or with a major event. I don't know if you guys heard about the Bitcoin crisis that's going on these days, but choosing an event like that, getting expert who has contact, and opening up to people we know, and to people who are interested in the Bitcoin community, for instance, would be a great lunch for us. So that's one opportunity. The other one is to connect with bloggers, with content providers, and create a platform that will help them advertise their opinion, and get them to create the content on our platform versus their blog. And they'll be getting some of the revenues that we get from ads and referrals in the beginning.
Yeah, I mean, the only other thing I'd caution you on is just that when everyone, when you go into public market investments, you think you're going to beat the market, you think there's some magic alpha, answer out there. And the fact of the matter is most people regress to the mean, and 5% a year is actually pretty good, and ETFs kind of do that for you sometimes. So I think it's also managing your customers' expectations that you're not going to make 20% every year or any year, maybe, and what is actually good and how they evaluate that.
Yep, that's right. Something that transparency is very important in our platform, because we don't want to be, I don't know if you guys know NerdWallet, and if you've used it in the beginning, it looks really good. But then you start when you start using the tools, you try to start to notice that they're advertising some more than others, they're getting better grades where it doesn't make sense. We don't want to be like that. Really want your first trusted network, their expertise, to drive your investment decisions.
Yeah.
Because
so
this is how I do.
Completely, yeah. On those, who the tentacles of the investment world are that are respected and that will bring those users. It's all about getting them.
Exactly. That's our niche, is the savvy investors and influencers like Yad, who have a network of people, some of them investors, others not. But if people trust them, they will join to get their content. That's what I did with Yad, and he introduced me to other people like him in New York. There are a lot of them.
Great job. Okay, so this is the fun part. If you'd like to pitch to Dana, please stand up. If you're already standing up, sit down. Okay, so these are the only people who want to come up here and pitch to Dana. Really? Okay, since we don't have too many people, you can put your hand down. So since we don't have too many people, usually we do a filter, but let's do something. You have one sentence. You can just say what you're doing, and then Dana will pick one of you to come up here each for 3 minutes. Lynn?
Hi, Lynn Greenberg, co-founder of Pivot.
One sentence.
No, you have one more sentence.
One more sentence. Thank you. We are a platform for people moving and on the move to connect you with your extended social network.
Hi, my name is David, and we are revolutionizing the traditional productivity office suite, merging three applications into one so you have all your information and contact available to work with.
Hi, my name is Ashwini, and my company lets brands get greater visibility into their consumers and more accurately calculate ROI.
Hi, we are a multi-sided marketplace for mentors, students, and companies for the jobs that don't require a college degree.
Not Cleverest is an open education platform that allows students and teachers to quiz themselves on any source-agnostic material.
I'm Sarah, founder of The Glass Files, and we're crowdsourcing history through family history.
Hello, I'm Realty for augmented realty technologies and virtual realty technologies automation for real estate and construction.
Sorry, could you say that again? It's hard to hear you. Can you repeat that? We can hear you.
What?
Can you say it again? We can hear you.
Sorry about it. Pandora Realty Technologies, our startup name, is for augmented realty and virtual reality automation tool for real estate and construction.
We are an AR app that lets you design spaces around you using the camera on your phone and product images around the web.
BusBot uses artificial intelligence to help city-to-city bus operators set smarter prices and schedules.
Evgeny Alexandrov, I'm the founder of Access Square. We innovate in investment research, specifically in corporate access, in basically kicking the last standing stool for the sell-side research analyst by providing more economical and bias-free access from investors to corporates.
I am Howard with Extreme Laser Technologies in New Jersey, and we have the world's safest non-lethal laser weapons. So Star Wars is here. And
did you say weapons?
Non-lethal safe weapons, they don't care.
Do they do? Okay.
They blind you to the fast couple sides.
They just blind you.
I'm Roxy. I have Hollywood Closet Rentals, which is a subscription service designed to rent out high-end wardrobe for influencers and content creators.
Amazing companies. Dana, which one do you like the most?
There were many amazing companies in there. I'm going to pick one based on just a problem that I haven't heard of being solved recently. So all of you had very interesting companies, but I didn't hear like a brand new problem that I hadn't heard a solution for recently, aside from the weapons one. I'm sorry, I'm not picking the weapons one. That I'm gonna do the history one.
There you go.
Thanks for selecting me. In 2007, I recorded my grandfather's memoir on videotape, and he told me for the first time, my family hadn't heard it before, the story of coming to the United States as a refugee during World War II and losing his family in the Holocaust. What I found at the time was that there was no place on the internet where families could safely preserve their stories. And the other problem that I discovered as I was, iterating through a prototype phase was that we are increasingly disconnected from history because the tools that are used to teach history make it difficult for us to relate our own lives to history. And so with the Gloss Files, which is a web app and a mobile app, families treasure their stories in private accounts and then selectively share media with cultural institutions and public history through a system of privacy levels and tags. We have found that there are basically applications for this software in pretty much all industries. Any organization that has a story to tell can use our site. And it allows them to build communities and do basically collaborative historical storytelling. But to start, because we just launched our web app in late October, we're focusing on four key organizations, and those are historical societies, schools, so educators were like on board with this, some of the first ones to really see the value. In their classrooms, their students are on the phones all the time and need a way to engage with them using digital. And then retirement communities who need meaningful entertainment, and then finally veterans associations who tend to be very serious about privacy. So we have about 2,000, over 2,000 customers on our site right now, and 850 of those are paying customers, because the way that we create a private environment for families is that we offer a freemium model where anybody can create an account on the site for free and upload media for free, but then in order to create a private family group, they subscribe $2 a month, and that fee will increase over time. So that's the Gloss Files. Thank you.
So I was interested in this one because, we're investors in 23andMe, and we see, even with 23andMe, really what people are trying to solve is the solution that Ancestry.com has provided, and Ancestry.com was started in 1997. Seems like it's time for something new here, and maybe 23andMe is part of it, but I think we can all see that that's a different solution in and of itself. I think it's compelling. I think there are two problems. There's just the storytelling aspect of what you're trying to get and preserve family memories, but then there's also just the historical part of it. And so I think from a family perspective, you're going to be limited, and my grandparents are except for one, have mostly passed away. I would have loved to have had this and had them record stuff, but that opportunity is gone, and so you can go short of my parents, but it's going to be years before my children appreciate that, and we, one generation away, have probably heard all the stories. So there's just this richness of content and discovering across families that I think it's great that you're focused on the privacy thing, but there is an entertainment value and historical conglomeration of data that you can create. And then there's the next part is maybe the validation. Like, how do you validate that these aren't just stories? My grandmother used to tell me we were descended from pirates. I thought that was really interesting, but I really don't think that's true. Yeah. So maybe it is, but it was just very hard to validate. So how do you add that historical element of real history to it and not another source of fakeness?
Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks so much to Dana for taking the time and giving feedback to the community. Thanks for coming. See you next month.